as we head towards November, one of the most important things that we have to realize, especially if you are a defender of the Constitution, especially if you are a defender of liberty and freedom and free enterprise, we need to realize that it is politically ignorant to put all of our eggs in one basket. We have to realize where political authority and political defense really comes from. And I have said time and again, in order for us to return to a nation that is full of freedom and liberty and prosperity, we have to return to a nation that concentrates on local elections. And that's why I'm very excited to welcome to welcome our next guest. Now, a lot of you are thinking, well, Josh, I live in New York. Why do I care about local politics? Because the discussion is relevant to you. And as we know, pockets of freedom need to be established anywhere they can be mounted. So welcome to the show, Randi, Shannon. Randi, welcome. How are you doing?
Thank you. I am doing great. I am so glad to be on your show. I've heard your name for such a long time, and you're definitely in the Liberty circle. So I'm extremely excited about being on your program today.
Well, that's always nice to hear. Thank you for that. I hope you had a great weekend, by the way. Now, you went to before we get into it, you went to a gun show, correct?
Yeah, Hawkeye Downs gun show. It lasts for 3 days in Cedar Rapids, and I was there. It wasn't the busiest one of the year, just because it's at graduation time, and
sure,
a lot of stuff. There was a lot of race car driving going on next door for this particular show, but I can tell you that this entire year we've had record numbers at these gun shows.
You know, the entire gun industry is just having a stellar, well, 2-3 years now. I mean, employment in the industry is up, and profits and dividends are up, so it's definitely something that's growing, and we can probably get into that and why you think that is. But first, tell us a little bit about you. Who are you? What's your background? I see you have a background in business, which I absolutely love. And more importantly, why are you deciding to walk away from the civilian life and pursue one in politics?
Well, okay, I am running for state senate. It is a part-time gig, which it should be. It lasts about 3 months out of the year, and a state senate seat will run for 4 years. I don't have anybody to primary against me, so I'm an automatic win on the ballot tomorrow night, so the vote will go for my election in November. And while I still will remain a business owner, I have about 15, 16 different ventures. And I've got a good group of people around me that will be able to maintain everything when I'm serving in the Senate. The reason I got involved is because I've progressively gotten madder and madder and madder. And you know, I'm tired of the government regulations, the overtaxation.
Well, Randi, Shannon, hold on 1 second. We kind of brought you on late mid segment, and we're up against a break, so we're going to carry this over. Don't go anywhere, folks. We'll continue this conversation right now. In America, the government was supposed to be and should be a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. And in order for that to happen, people like you and I have to say, okay, I have had enough of this. I'm going to take some time away, and I'm going to go fix the problem. And I love it when just average people who don't want to be professional politicians decide to step up to the plate and say, hey, I'll go. And that's one of the people we're talking to today. Her name is Randi Shannon. She's running for Iowa State Senate in District 34. Now, before we went to the break, we kind of hinted that you went to a gun show over the weekend. I love gun shows. That's very, very awesome.
Mm-hmm.
The Second Amendment is always a hotbed issue in any election cycle. What have you been observing from a Second Amendment perspective that people in Iowa and around the nation, for that matter, should be made aware of?
Well, this gun show was particularly pretty interesting. For the first time this year, this was my third gun show this year that I've attended. I always put a booth out and inform people about my run. I give them a sheet that talks about my different issues. Same thing you can find on shannonforsenate.com. And this year, the ATF showed up. Now, of course, you can imagine that incited all kinds of emotions in people, and
none of
which are happy. I had a conversation with them that was pretty interesting. I won't get into all of it, but one of the gentlemen, there was three of them, and one of the gentlemen, when I asked him, what are you guys doing here, he actually made the mistake and then corrected it. And this is what he said. We're here to ask questions, answer people's questions. So he started this, and how I just did it for you is how he did it to me. So it was ask questions. It was basically interrogating as many of the gun sellers as possible and people that are walking around. But then he flipped it mid-sentence to correct himself, to say answer people's questions. Yeah.
Now, you said the ATF was there this year. Is the ATF usually not present at Iowa gun shows?
I have not seen them. This was the third gun show this year in 2012. And this was the first one this year that they attended. And they were not well received, I can assure you. Many people went up to them and said, why are you here? And, you know, the thing is it's intimidation and sales drop. And, you know, one of the gentlemen that was nearby with his booth sells these full-size posters of Obama that you can do whatever you want with. Some people go out and have a little fun with them, if that makes sense. And his sales dropped way down. And they're constantly leaning into...
That goes without saying.
Yeah, exactly. And so, you know, these ATF guys were constantly leaning into people. And your name is, and your name is, and just constantly trying to get as much information out of the people as they possibly could. So they were not well received.
And then they wonder why gun sales are up in this country. The thing about gun sales is whenever the people feel oppressed, the sale of guns always increase. And we've seen that when Obama first took office. It was almost like watching one of those cartoon stock market tickers where the sale of guns just kept going, and right through the roof it went. So this idea that the ATF's presence is somehow going to stem that, well, it might stem it at this particular show. But it actually is one of the causes for the increase in the first place, this idea that people are constantly being watched and observed.
That's right. So, you know, in my opinion, that's one agency that needs to go. We just, it's a government overreach. They may do some good, but I think it's an agency that needs to just be completely gotten rid of.
Well, now, you're running for state senate, and there's a lot that has come up in the news cycles over the past, 24 months about this rise in states that want to implement 10th Amendment rights and that whole 10th Amendment issue. The ATF would fall under one of those headers where, as a representative, you could say, we don't want you in our state.
That's right. We could. And, you know, what it's going to take is politicians that have the guts to stand up, sheriffs, and governors. Mm-hmm. That's what it's going to take to make that happen. And quite frankly, I've gotten into some very private conversations with high-ranking senators in the state, and they say flat out the governors and the sheriffs don't have the guts to stand up to these things. And actually, there was an admission that they all know Obama is illegally sitting. They know it. This, I assure you, came from high-ranking senators, and I said, well, then why are we obeying health care and the implementation of it, and it's bankrupting the states, you know, and just all of these illegal laws that he's handing down, and they said, because these guys don't have the guts. It's going to take a group of people that have the guts to stand up to it, and we don't have it.
No,
at least not on the surface. Not on the surface.
Randi, did you just go into the president is not legally able to hold the office in which he currently sits territory?
I did.
Oh, it is so refreshing to see politicians who are running for office stand up and say, hey, wait a second, we have questions. Let's just go there because I can't ignore that. What are some of the things that say to you, wait a second, we really need to look into this?
That say to me personally?
Yeah, I mean, because obviously Donald Trump has his birth certificate thing that he's like, hey, this birth certificate's not real. Hillary Clinton, for those who forget, Hillary Clinton was the person who brought this to the nation's attention in the first place. Some people, their trigger is that the press release or the junket packet from Obama's publisher where he claims to be Kenyan-born. What is it for you that says, hey, wait a second, he shouldn't be here?
Well, all of the above. I actually own a web design company, and when they put that birth certificate out, however long ago that was now, my people, forget the press, forget Joe Arpaio, forget all of that. My people had it cracked in 2 minutes in our office. We knew that thing was a fraud then. And what was great is people were, these guys were actually putting YouTube videos up. Now, I didn't have my team do it, but we sure as heck started talking about it to everybody. And, you know, it's obvious this guy hates America. It's obvious he hates Americans. He hates our freedom.
True.
He hates the fact we have the most resources in the entire world. And, you know, I heard somewhere, and I cannot confirm where I heard it, but I heard that he was asked, how much tax is enough? And his response was 100%. So, you know, this guy hates us. And,
well,
you know, every step he takes proves it.
Well, and here's the thing. For those people who are progressive voters out there, they might say, well, Josh, he doesn't really hate us. He loves us. He just has a different way of getting us there. That's really the crux of it, because that's where we find ourselves, Randi. We're at a place now where there are Americans who want to remain Americans. There are people like you and I who want to be free. However, we are witnessing a change in the foundation. I mean, what is it? 4 out of 10 people now rely on the government for their income. So we're witnessing this change where some people are saying, you know what, I don't need to be free. And I've had an alarming amount of conversations over the past month with people who point blank say, you know what, it's not really that important to me to be free. It's not really that important that I have privacy. Matter of fact, if I have privacy, it's only because I have something that I want to hide. So there's this mindset that's actually following along with Obama, and they're saying in their minds, well, he doesn't hate America. He loves the new America.
Well, I think there's more of us that love the old America, and I think that we don't appreciate them wanting us to throw away what our ancestors did to give us that freedom. Ben Franklin, what did you give us? A republic, if you know how to keep it, if you can keep it. And you know, we all have ancestors that were somewhat a part of that, and I'm not going to turn my back on that because somebody came along and wants a new America. And the thing is all these handouts and things, they all just feel good to all these people that don't have to work, and we are at a tipping point, which does, you know, bring me back to a couple of the conversations I had with police officers. I will not say which cities, because I don't want to expose them. But
well, Randi, hold on right there. We're up against another break. I know, 10 minutes goes fast with amazing conversation. And we'll just tease the audience with those conversations with the officers. Don't go anywhere, folks. We'll be back with Randi Shannon right after this. You know, whenever we talk to politicians, the conversation is usually kind of dry and boring. You know, politicians like to talk about, well, inflationary rates of the 1300s. And, you know, it's just these really boring conversations. But, you know, you have to do it because politics is, as Mark Twain said, sports for adults. But once in a while, you get a politician where it just becomes exciting. And that entire break, I wanted to get back here to hear about these conversations with police. Police, of course, that will remain nameless, but I still want to know. So, Randi, pick up where you left off.
Okay. I'd like to address just that. I am not your typical politician. I've never run for anything in my life. I've been almost a 20-year business owner, and I've dabbled in so many things that, you know, I've lived a very interesting life, and I am not afraid to go over the edge on this side and over the edge on this side, and that's what's made life very interesting. So I'm also not afraid to talk to cops and ATF people, and I talked to a couple of the police officers, and I was surprised at how open one of them in particular was to me. And he came up to me, and because I'm running, definitely felt like I was someone that he could give information to, which I love the information. I won't expose who he is, but here's what he said. We are going to have civil war, and that all of the counties and the states and the local communities are preparing for this. And I said, well, how do you know we're going to have? You know, I play dumb. I play like I don't know everything just so I can get more information out. And I said, well, how do you know? What's making you feel this way? And he said, because we are at the tipping point. And I said, well, who is the war going to be with? And he said, the haves and the have-nots. that the government dole is finally at the point where there's now more pulling out of it than there is putting into it, and the haves have had it. And it's going to happen. And he made it sound like it's sooner rather than later, like most definitely this year, and they are completely prepared. And he also mentioned that they had two arsenals that really nobody knows about, and that is for preparation, yeah, of this civil war in our country. And the other one that I spoke to has become a friend over the course of the gun shows, and he has stated the same thing, and also stated to me in the first gun show that I met him at that the chief of police did indeed go to every single officer and ask, what will you do if the government says, take the guns away from the people? So that particular chief, I know. And I know that he was asking that question to see who the friends and the foes are. He is a good man. So he was asking to see, guaranteed, who his rogue cops are. So they are figuring it out, and they know this.
Okay. Obviously, there's a couple questions here. I believe that people are preparing for something for a long time. I talked to a lawyer who's a progressive. I mean, I don't even politically agree with this woman, but she was in her mid-50s, and she said, Josh, I bought my first gun when I had a conversation with my neighbor, and we jokingly said, would you ever come into my house in order to steal from my freezer? And when he didn't smile, I knew I needed to buy a gun. So there's obviously this realization that people are facing something, something's coming. And
yeah.
I keep telling people that it's not going to be a situation where it's going to be the people versus the government. I mean, that's just ludicrous. They have drones and bombs that can target you by your DNA. And this isn't the 1800s. It's not musket versus musket. Mm-hmm. If there's going to be a civil war, it is going to be the people versus the people. And I suggest, and I want to get your input on this since you're running for political office, I suggest that that's actually the design of the government, because the government, if they have evil intentions, they know that they can't just roll in and say, okay, martial law. But if the people fight each other, then the people will actually welcome their own demise. Isn't that true?
That is 100% true. And people don't understand the snare that we are all walking in. But at the same time, something's got to change because the politicians don't have the guts to change it. I mean, if they did, Obama would be gone. He would be out of office. Holder would be gone. You know, we have 435 representatives, 9 judges, and a president. I mean, 99% of them would be out of office. And even in the 2010 election, when we all thought, wow, we're getting in all these people, we've taken it over, don't we all hear just absolute silence? Nothing changed. It's like they all got in there, and what, did they all get the life threat, the family threat? Because nothing
good
come out of them.
You know, that is such a brilliant question, because I have thought the exact same thing. And I was actually out there speaking back then. I was part of this. I'm like, okay, vote for XYZ. I don't want to name names. And then all of a sudden, these people who I was speaking on behalf of get into office, and they do the exact opposite. All of a sudden, exactly. I don't know if they pulled them down into a room someplace and said, hey, you either play the game or we off your kid or what.
That's what I think. Because if you take a look at some that were the most outspoken, that, you know, I was excited that got in. Alan West, for example. And guess what?
Yes.
He voted for NDAA.
Not only did he vote for it, Randi, but then he went out and tried to spin it where he says, well, it doesn't entail indefinite detention. And then in reality, when the regular public got their hands on it and started reading it, said, well, actually, yes, it does. So he knew it did. He was just trying to cover it. And we had all those candidates. You know, 2010 was supposed to be this liberty takeover, and 99.9% of them got threatened or something. And it just makes you think, what happened? Because they were so passionate while they were running for office that you thought, well, there is no way you're going to compromise. So the obvious question here is, I mean, obviously you're running for state office instead of federal office, but I have to ask you the question, are you going to compromise? And your answer, I'm going to hold you to it.
Yeah, no, I'm not compromising at all. And the thing is what I've said, and I've stated openly all along, is, you know, things, for example, like taxes. I took a pledge with the D.C. watchdog group, Americans for Tax Reform. My opponent ignored it, and I called him up, and I said, give me that pledge. I'm going to sign it right now. And it says I will oppose and fight any and all raising of taxes. So I hold that out. It's on my website. I put it on my gun show booth table. You know, I'm right out there in the open, and I've stated that I will daily report back what's going on in the Senate. So I'm probably looked at as the bad guy. I mean, you know, I really probably should think about having a bodyguard once I get in, because I'm not going to turn. I'm not going to roll. And the good thing is, at least I feel like it's a good thing right now, is, you know, I've made great friends that are liberty-minded. We know who each other is. And, you know, we all have a plan to get in there and hold firm and hold fast to the no tax hikes, find these pork projects, get rid of them, and turn this around. Our ancestors came over here because Europe was doing a 2.5% tax or a tax increase.
Right.
Yeah, we are paying, good God, if people really sat down and did the math, you're probably paying out about 85% in tax. And you think, no, no way, I only paid 13% or 35% or whatever it is you're paying. But every time you spend a dollar, you're paying tax. Try to get gas or food or clothing. They tax
everything.
Well, and
this is what people don't realize either with the way the tax system works. Once you take a dollar and you spend it 10 times, that dollar ceases to exist. And people haven't even fathomed this. But once once it's spent 10 times, it no longer exists. So we need to print another one to replace it. And because of our economic system, whenever we print money, we actually go in debt to print a dollar. It costs $1.10 to make a dollar, so it's impossible for us at this point with this current system to ever get out of debt, because as soon as we paid it off, that created debt in and of itself.
That's right. And, you know, because our country is in, I mean, in reality, what I've heard is that it's over $500 trillion debt. The $15 trillion, that's just for the dumb sleeping people, okay? That's just, it's a fraud, it's a fake. It were really, with derivatives and everything else, over $500 trillion in debt. And the Federal Reserve, by the way, which is not truly a federal organization, is up for lease this year. And what I understand is a lot of the rats have left the nest and are every day leaving the nest and headed down to their sunny mansions down in all the Latin American countries. There will be a few here that will continue to fight to keep it, but I just don't even know what we have become as a nation.
Well, Randi, yeah, I had you only slated for the first hour, but this is kind of fun. Do you have time? Can you come back in the second hour?
Yeah, absolutely. Let's go.
All right. Well, cool. All right, folks, then we're going to carry over to the second hour. Make sure you're there. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back right after this.
Transmission begins. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
This is the Josh Tolley Show on the GCN Radio Network.
Your founding fathers did not risk their lives. Those who fell for freedom did not pay the ultimate price so you could have a government paycheck. They didn't sacrifice their livelihood so you could be dependent on a new form of America. They died for a nation that was based on freedom. They died for a nation that was based on liberty. And I get asked all the time, Josh, why do you say liberty and freedom? What's the difference? Well, there is a difference. Freedom is what you are born with. Liberty is the collective people recognizing what you are born with. That's why there's freedom and liberty. You need to fight for both. You need to promote both. And whenever we get a chance to help a politician, to expose a politician to the masses who is fighting for that same thing, we love the opportunity to do that. And that's exactly what we're doing today. We're talking to Randi Shannon, who's running for Iowa State Senate in District 34. Now, we were getting into some heavy stuff, Randi, and then we had a long break. So I kind of want to get back into it. You have kind of warned us, really, of law enforcement's idea that there is a coming civil war between the haves and have-nots. You've addressed issues such as taxes and gun rights. What are some of the other issues that we need to look at that we think are only national issues, but we really need to start addressing them from a local and state and county basis.
Well, the, you know, overregulation is insane. I have a friend, in fact, he's running for U.S. House, and his name is Rod Blum. He's up in the Dubuque area, a good, good man. We hope he makes it through the primary tomorrow, because he's running against a typical GOP establishment guy who got a taste of D.C. and wants to go back. So I've been in very, very lengthy conversations with him, and he is a good man. He's like Ron Paul, Rand Paul. He's one that we want in there. And he is the underdog, unfortunately. But he was telling me a story about how he was going to develop a really nice piece of land, and the EPA stepped in and said, well, look, if you're going to do something to this land, then we want you to put in the water sanctuary type areas.
Wetlands?
Yeah, wetlands. And they have certain areas in the state where they would want that put in. So literally, he had a $50 million project he was going to do, a development in the Dubuque area. And the EPA, after all their regulations and rules and statutes that they had handed down, he would have had to have spent $50 million to put in these wetlands somewhere else. I think it was around Sioux City, the two opposite ends of the state. So it made it so he couldn't even do the development project. Literally, the man would have worked for nothing. So that is the definition of insanity. And EPA needs to go. And there's other organizations that would step in and police polluters and things like that that really do, you know, need to go away. So regulations are just out of control.
Hold on one second. Yeah. Especially from a federal level, because a lot of people don't understand, because of our wonderful tongue-in-cheek school system, a lot of people don't understand that the United States of America is still the United States. The states were supposed to be independent. And when you have a lot of overshadowing federal regulation that comes from Washington, D.C., you take away the very nature of independent states, because the benefit to being independent was the ability to compete with each other. So Iowa could say, well, we'll offer, you know, this sort of freedom or liberty or business incentive, and then Wisconsin would have to say, well, no, you come here because we'll offer this or this, and it allowed a nature of competition among 50 states. And the great thing about that is whenever there's competition, the people always win. You see the same thing with movie ticket prices. When there's more than one theater, ticket prices go down. When even with your husband or wife, when you have a lot of options to choose from, you have a tendency to pick the one that's best for you, as opposed to, you know, hey, you're the only man left on the planet, I got to settle for you. So that whole idea of bringing the power to the states in order to allow them to compete on a national scale is vitally important, and it's something that your office, if you win, I hope you do, it's something that your office is really the front line of defense for.
Yeah, it really is. And I'll even take what you just said one step further. It's the power of the states, but even more powerful, and it's in the Constitution, and it doesn't say we the states, it says we the people. Right. It's the people. We control the states. We control
the
state. Iowa could be an empty state. There could be five people here or no people here, and there's no power of the state at that point. It's the people that make the power. So all this government overreach is exactly that, overreach. Because, quite frankly, not only is the federal government ignoring we the people, but the states are ignoring we the people. And that's where, in my mind, that the tipping point has gotten to. There couldn't be more on the government dole if it wasn't the government overreaching and taking it from the workers, the ones who are generating the proceeds and the profits. And, you know, you hear about, corporate people, you know, the Occupy and the corporate people are the bad guys. Well, go back 200 years, and just about everybody then was a business owner, Now flop that around, fast forward 200 years, and most everybody is a worker. There's hardly any, you know, business owners in, by comparison anymore. And, you know, the only two organizations, the only two businesses, I guess, and I say that really lightly, that grew in the last 20 years were not traditional business, not the 15 companies that I own. It's government grew the fastest, and the medical slash pharma industry grew the fastest. Now, there's something wrong with that.
What you point out is fascism, because government has gotten involved in those industries, and those industries then are in bed with the government, and it's a benefit both to the government and the people in that industry to help each other. And starting in 1913, what happened is the government became a business itself. We took away the ability for it to regulate itself, and governments do that through the issuance of currency. Once we took that away, the government became a business, and any business, you know this, any business has competition. And the competition for government is freedom. And right now, what people in Iowa are needing to decide between you and your opponent is, do they want somebody who wants to get into office and say, hey, you have problems. If you elect me, I can go to the government and get them to fix them for you. Or do you want somebody like Randi who says, you have problems. If you elect me, I'll go to the government and get them out of the way so you can fix them. And that's
right.
Really the two schools of thought.
And, you know, the Republican Party has started somewhat in the state of Iowa, we'll start with the governor, to cut some of these overreaching, typically Democrat liberal programs. And I got to say, yesterday, basically the first two people that came up to me at the gun show said, I'm really pissed off at the governor because he cut, and it was, one was a blanket overreach program where they gave every single child in the state of Iowa free preschool. So what that did, you think, oh, well, you know, that doesn't sound like a bad program. What's wrong with Randi? What's wrong with the governor that he cut this? Well, churches ran programs, and, you know, they made a little bit of money. And guess what? They were inflicting in your child a Bible base, a foundation, and now they're competing with the government's free. So when people have free or pay $150 or $200 at this daycare, what are they
going to
take?
Okay, Randi, we're up against yet another break. This is kind of unprecedented, but you want to stick around for one more?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, folks. We'll be back right after this. Free enterprise is the fuel for freedom. Without free enterprise, we have no freedom. You know, a lot of people who say they love America, they love history, they love the Constitution, what we fail to realize is your founding fathers, they died for free enterprise. They fought for the ability to own, to have property. And a lot of people, I get it, a lot of people tell you in school, well, what they fought for was freedom of religion. Well, you know, that's not entirely true. They fought for taxation without representation issues, which were linked to free enterprise. They actually had freedom of religion. That's a lie that's what they fought for. America was here for over 100 years prior to the Revolution. And that's why, once we started our nation, the Danbury Baptists wrote a letter to Thomas Jefferson, because now that we were a nation, they thought their religious freedom was going to be taken away. So we already had that. They fought, bled, and died for the ability to own, the ability to have a business. And business ownership, the idea of teaching people how to become business owners, is vital if we're going to continue as a nation. So, Randi, I'd like to get into that a little bit. You know, whenever I go speak, I carry with me a textbook that's from 1930, and it talks about how to start a business. That's a textbook, a seventh-grade textbook from 1930. We don't teach that anymore. What's the importance of getting entrepreneurship back into our culture from a political perspective?
Well, it's critical because, like before the break, where I talked about the government cutting a program that had been instilled, I'm assuming by the previous governor, I don't know all the details on it, but you know, when the government is just blanket statementing free this across the board, it puts small business out of business. And that is what fuels our economy and fuels our nation. And it was that, I mean, think about it. The United States of America was the superpower. We were, we had the highest credit ratings. We were what everyone pretty much, you know, that thinks like a republic. There isn't too many. The word always thrown around is democracy, but we are a republic,
right.
What's left of it. That's what these other countries wanted to emulate. Unless they were run by a dictator, they wanted what we had. We have been the envied nation of the world, and we have lost that. If you talk to anybody out of our country right now, they don't want to be here. There's more people leaving our country than coming into our country. And
you know, that's a point I think most people overlook, that more people are leaving than coming in, and there's more illegal immigrants that are actually leaving than are coming in as well. And it's because of entrepreneurship. We became the wealthiest, most powerful nation the world has ever known, and we did it in a record amount of time. We did it in a global blink of an eye, and it was all because of our ability to teach entrepreneurship. And we're at a place now where if we look at the teaching of entrepreneurship and we look at how people vote, the two are related. When Steve Jobs died, everybody was talking about, oh, what a great contribution he made, and oh, it was so wonderful. Meanwhile, the majority of the people who were praising him wouldn't want their kids to do the same thing he did, which was drop out of college to start a business. So while we admire what has come before us, it's not something that we want to have continue in the future, and that's actually a death wish, isn't it?
It is it's the final nail in the coffin, what we are going through right now. I just posted a story earlier this morning about this bailout money that went to, I believe it was GM, and most of it went out of the country, and they have 7 joint ventures with China. So here our tax dollars bailed them out, and in turn, the production was coming out of China and 7 more joint ventures. So we the nation, are just rolling over and allowing them to take all of our tax dollars. I mean, did you agree to any of that? Nobody asked me.
Nope.
So it's against our wishes, and people have not risen up. My form of rising up is running, but quite frankly, I don't know if that's strong enough.
So what are you suggesting? What would be a stronger alternative?
I said this 1 week ago to Stuart Rhodes on the Johnny Storm radio program. I said, we need to march in there. We need to, where are the men with the guts to march into the White House and arrest these people for high treason? Every one of them that voted for NDAA and CISPA and the czars, the 50 czars, which the very definition means dictator, and anybody affiliated with the IRS, and especially the ones, the most grievous ones that have come down on good people, the ones doing the raids on the families for selling raw milk or aloe vera or pigs that don't have any other color but pink on them. We need to march across this nation and arrest these people for committing high treason. That's it.
You know,
that is our answer. We are left with one answer.
So I have to ask, obviously, the follow-up question, why do you think that hasn't happened? Because there are a lot of people who say that you're absolutely right. We just need to start arresting people. What they've done is treasonous. If we were to look back 10 years and told ourselves, well, let's go back a little further because it already started. Let's go back 20 years. If I would have told you in the 90s, well, in the future, we're going to have 30,000 drones over our head. You're going to be followed by cameras that can track 36 million people at a time. You won't be able to eat any food you want. You won't be able to raise livestock that you want. In 17 states, Randi, it's illegal to collect rainwater. Would you have said that would have happened in your America?
Never. Never, not
then,
in a million years. I would have never.
Why do you think there isn't? Then why do you think there isn't some sort of? And I don't want to say violent uprising. That's not what we're advocating. But why do you think there isn't a more active uprising of the men in this country who do exactly what you said. If, like, for example, if we know that what they're doing is treasonous, where are the other senators, for that matter, not even the citizens? Where are the senators who did vote against NDAA, calling the sergeant at arms to arrest the people who have, and then let the courts figure out if that's treasonous or not? Because I contend you can make a very good argument that it is treasonous.
Oh, yeah, and I would agree with you, and I think everybody else in the heartland would as well. Where are these people? I'm not really sure. I know Stuart Rhodes with the Oath Keepers is having to tread lightly because the long arm of our government law has come down on him saying he's calling for violence. We have good people that stand up here and there. Breitbart, murdered. The coroner who took over Breitbart's case, murdered. Arsenic poisoning. We got Joe Arpaio, who's getting all the death threats. Fox News apparently is all a bunch of wussies because they roll over and don't say a thing. I think we have a lot of men that are preparing. Now, will they step up to the plate with the guts before it's too late, before the drones are used on us? I will say this, that same police officer told me that he cannot wait for the drones to come. And he seemed like a relatively good guy. And he said that to me, and I said, why would you say that? A man looking over the fence at your wife would go to prison. But you can right. look over the fence from the sky, and it's okay? And his response to me was, we police ourselves. I said, you are crazy.
Well, Shannon... ShannonForSenate.com is the website. ShannonForSenate.com, all one word. Randi, we're going to have you back on the show because you're just fun to talk to. We'll be back right after this. We have two segments left, and there's some things I want to cover. Don't go anywhere. You know when you have a good meal and you think, oh, man, that was really good, and then you decide, well, what the heck, I still have a little room left in me. Let me go back and get some more. That's what we're going to do now. Very, very rarely do I have so much fun talking to politicians. There seems to be a disconnect between the logic, reason, and strategy that I use and the political mindset. However, we have found an exception to that rule, who understands exactly where I'm coming from, who understands exactly, more importantly, where you are coming from, which makes her a great representative of the people because it's by the people and for the people. So, with a little bit of an encore presentation, Randi, let's talk about moving forward. I mean, you've hinted on the fact that we need to stand up to Obama and really truly investigate his legitimacy as eligible to hold the office in which he retains. You've talked about how you've spoken with law enforcement officers, and they're kind of saying, wink, wink, get ready. We have hidden arsenals, and there's a coming civil war between you, the people, and we're going to step in between that. You've hinted at the corruption within the political system. A lot of people, though, are afraid to step up. How do people handle that fear? From your perspective, what words of wisdom would you have? Because you're doing it. I mean, many people get frustrated, but very few get frustrated to the point where they're like, fine, I'm going to go to the courthouse, I'm going to file my papers to run for office. So you stood up. How can other people do the same thing? What's holding them back?
Well, there's a lot of ways that people can get involved and fight back. I could talk for 15 hours on this. Let me just give some bullets. First of all, I admire Stuart Rhodes' work of Oath Keepers. I think he's a little tame in comparison to what I would be. He talks about preparation. I say massively be prepared, okay? This isn't going to be a one-night deal.
Yeah. Hold on one second. I just have to interject. She just said Stuart Rhodes is tame. Stuart Rhodes is somebody that the Southern Poverty Law Center classifies as a terrorist threat. So to have Stuart Rhodes be tame is quite a comment, and I'm sure you'd enjoy it. Okay, so be prepared. What should we be prepared for? What do you think is really coming at us?
Okay, if these cops are right, and they're just, you know, the last two I heard over the weekend, look, people have been saying this for a long time coming. So be prepared. Don't have one day of food. You need to have a minimum, my mind, 1 year of food, and don't store it all right where they're going to know where it's at. Have some, I think they're called caches or sachets, something like that, where you're spreading it around. Have some different locations. You may be forced out of your home during this. Be prepared for that. Don't take this lightly. We've never experienced in our lifetime civil war. We need to be prepared mentally. Go talk to a war veteran. My grandfather is a World War II vet, and, you know, the biggest thing is fear. You cannot have fear. And the best way to not have fear is to have the exact opposite. You need to have some comfort. You need to be in a comfort zone. Well, if you know you've got food someplace, you know you're not going to be fearing hunger. Another thing is self-defense. You can't be fearful of who's going to come to your door. So you need to be well-versed in self-defense. Find the gun range and go. Spend the money on the ammo, get a gun, and practice, practice, practice. And the more you practice reloading and, you know, when the gun does the freeze-up and it's clogged, you got to figure out how to get out of those situations. And you need to be well-versed and fast. So get to the gun ranges, take your kids, teach them how. This is what our ancestors did. These kids were fighting in these battles at age 12. And if your kid's just sitting around gaming all day, you need to fix that right now. Shut off the TV, get rid of the cable because they're all liars anyway. Get on all the alternative radio if that's what you know, if you need to get news. Shut that stuff off. Take the money, buy ammo. And I'm not joking about this. Every day the ammo is going up. From the first gun show I went to the second gun show, it went up 30%. Wow. From the second to the third, it went up at least another 15%. And the government, they're stating, the officers have stated, probably won't do a gun grab. They're going after the ammo and the components. So make sure you have, get a man in your life that knows something about guns and learn. Have what you need. Be prepared. Don't let this catch you off guard. I just had some people that were just out of the blue out to my place yesterday looking at barn board, and through the conversation I found out that they got four underground bunkers already ready and prepped. They go to the Mormon stores and buy mass quantities of food because they sell it in mass quantity. The Amish stores is another good location. Find these places and buy in bulk. Get prepared. If you lose these different things that make you fearful for what is potentially coming, and I am not advocating violence, I don't need the government coming down on me, or ATF showing up at my door, I'm not advocating it, but for damn sure, if they come and they are the ones bringing it on, there's going to be a problem. So, and there needs to be a problem at your house, too. And then there's other things. Look, we need to stop the government from taking so much. I implore everybody to go research land patents. There's a lot of people filing these. I was talking to a gentleman. He helped 15 people file these, and 14 passed through immediately. And what it does is I can't explain it fully, but basically it ends. Look, we, the people, are to own our property. We are not to be taxed on it. Try not paying your tax on your property one time, and guess what? They're going to be taking your land. That yep. is treason. So you need to file a land patent, and it protects you against everything, and they cannot take your properties from you. So do some research on that.
Some of the other things that I would add to that, just from a strategic standpoint, because I do kind of have a well-versed background in this sort of thing, have from a weapon standpoint, have an additional weapon. A knife is a very good thing to be versed in. It's quiet, and it's also you don't have to reload it. So always having an alternative defense weapon. Another thing is have something that's worth fighting for. I think one of the biggest problems we face now is our ancestors, those who went before us, understood what they were fighting for. Sometimes we've become so numb and so hollow, so soulless as people that we don't have anything really worth fighting for, nothing worth defending. And I tell people this all the time. If you have nothing worth dying for, then you have nothing worth living for. So take the time to decide what's important to you. Develop good relationships with your spouse, your children. If you believe in a creator, well, then get involved in that. Don't just have a passive life. Because when we have a passive life, it's easy to take it away. And also start realizing the strategy of any adversary. Right now, odds are you're not going to be fighting some sort of government incursion. They're smarter than that. Right now, they know that if they pit each other against each other, That's right. Us against each other, then they don't have to fire a shot. You know, there's that old saying, when your enemy's shooting your enemy, just duck and get out of the room. And they've created that environment, so now they can come along next and become the benevolent savior. They can say, oh, see, because there was so much strife among a free people, what we need to do is regulate you from a federal level so everybody will get along and we can bring peace. And in reality, all they're really doing is bringing the walls around you and creating a zoo animal. So there's some things that go along with that. Now, what do we do then? Right now, from a political standpoint, I mean, do we just roll over and take the presidential nominee that they want to provide to us?
No.
Or do we take a stand and say, no, nobody but liberty and freedom?
Nobody but liberty and freedom. Don't buy into their system at all. Don't listen to what the news stations are saying. They're lying. I'm in the trenches. I know this firsthand. It's a lie. And the Republican front runner, so they say, is truly not the front runner. They say he has the delegate votes. It's presumptive votes. Well, what they're saying in essence is that they're presuming which way I will vote. And they cannot presume that. And so it's off of the presumptive votes that they're calling the election for him. That is an out and out lie. And it's criminal. I understand there is a class action lawsuit that has been filed. Yeah, and that process, the way they've handled it, needs to stop.
Shannon for Senate. Shannon, we're up against a break. ShannonForSenate.com.
America's number one source for independent talk radio for over a decade. We are the GCN Radio Network.
Digestive health is the key to wellness and elimination of toxins. That bears repeating. Digestive health is the key to wellness and elimination of toxins. And Pro-EM-1 Daily Probiotic Cleanse is the key to digestive health. Pro-EM-1 is a powerful liquid probiotic, strong enough to cleanse, gentle enough to use every day. Pro-EM-1 is dairy, wheat, and soy-free, contains all natural and certified organic ingredients, contains no preservatives or animal products, supports a healthy digestive and immune system, supports weight loss, improves absorption of food nutrients, aids in controlling yeast infections, is never freeze-dried, and uses three groups of live, viable, beneficial microbes to cleanse and remove toxins. Order Pro-EM-1 Daily Probiotic Cleanse at Terraganics.com, spelled TerraganiX.com, Terraganics.com. Or call toll-free 866-369-3678. That's 866-369-3678. Pro-EM-1, the raw probiotic.
If you owe the IRS money you can't pay, then listen carefully, because you already know that the problem won't go away by itself. You can get help today from the leading tax expert in the country, Dan Pilla.
Hi, I'm Dan Pilla. The IRS isn't going to just forget about you. Right now, the IRS is hiring thousands of tax collectors to go after delinquent accounts just like yours. That's why you need to take action today, and I can help. I take a simple but proven approach to solving your tax debt problem. First, I stabilize collections so you don't have to worry about wage and bank levies. Next, I build a detailed plan to get your debt reduced to the fullest extent possible, sometimes even eliminated. Finally, I work with you every step of the way to get your problem solved once and for all. So call now for a free consultation. Call 1-800-346-6829.
Dan Pilla will solve your tax problem, guaranteed. He's helped thousands of people, and he can help you too. Call us today at 800-346-6829. That's 800-34-NO-TAX.
Attention, mindless criminals, thugs, and thieves. Go ahead, break a leg. American homeowners are fed up with your door kick-ins and forced entries. We now dare you to try your boot against any door reinforced with the Door Sentinel. The Door Sentinel pack includes a steel door jam plate with 3.5-inch screws, a lock shield, and hinge shields. The Door Sentinel installs in minutes, securing any front, side, or back doors, even French doors. Criminals, be forewarned, your leg will break before the Door Sentinel will budge. Even if you have an alarm system, back it up with the Door Sentinel. Basic products starting under $20. Order your Door Sentinel today for your home, garage, or any building you own or rent at MySafeDoor.com. That's MySafeDoor.com or call 678-648-6757. That's 678-648-6757. Get your peace of mind back with Door Sentinel. The Door Sentinel. Always on guard.
Hello?
Congratulations.
For what?
For losing all that weight. How'd you do it so fast?
ASAP.
ASAP what? What's that mean?
Are you ready to get as skinny as possible, as soon as possible, as simple as possible, and as sexy as possible?
I'm listening.
Then get with the ASAP program. It's real and it works. No smooth talk, no slick advertising, and no exaggerated claims of success.
I've got to know more.
Welcome to ASAP, as slim as possible. Whether you have 10, 20, or 50 pounds to lose, ASAP is your weight loss answer. ASAP targets the abnormal fat reserves and makes them available to be burned as fuel and contains no caffeine or hormones. Order ASAP at wholesale prices or join the team to share the business with others. Visit GCNteam.com or call 877-878-4203. GCNteam.com or call 877-878-4203. Lose weight and look great with ASAP, as slim as possible.